in his message in the previous hour, Brother Lindsay dealt with the fact that Moses said, and said repeatedly really, their God is not as our God. Speaking of the heathen all around them in the wilderness, in Egypt, and later in the land of Canaan, their God is not like our God. Moses said, their rock is not as our rock. And when he said that, he is simply repeating their own words. This one that the children of Israel called God, he's not like our God. Their rock is not like our rock. And never were truer words spoken. Everywhere you go in this generation, both in the secular world and the religious world, where the folks are cussing in his name, using his name as a byword, or speaking in religious terms of his name, you hear about God and Jesus. You can't hardly turn the television on without somebody mentioning the name. But the Jesus of this age, the Savior of this age, the Christ of this age, the one that's commonly known among men, he is not at all like the Christ of God. For that reason, I've been trying in these recent messages on Sunday mornings to identify for you the Christ of God. Who is the Christ? There's only one. And whosoever believeth that Jesus is that Christ, he is born of God. And any other Christ is no God and no Savior at all. If you worship a false God, if you worship a false Christ, you may as well bow down and dance around a totem pole like some barbarian. He who is the Christ of God, he alone is our Savior. With that in mind, turn with me to Hebrews chapter 1. More than 700 years before he came into this world, the prophet Isaiah wrote about the greatness, the superiority, and the excellence of our Lord Jesus Christ. He said, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government, that is all government, shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever." And then the prophet concluded that prophecy by saying, "The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." This is what God has said. This is what God shall do. And then when the angel 700 years later appeared to Mary and announced that though she was a virgin, having never known a man, that virgin woman would conceive and bring forth a son by the power of God the Holy Ghost, and that her child would be the Son of God, the Savior of his people, Jesus. The angel said, "He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, the Son of the Most Excellent, the Highest God, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end." That is, there shall be no limit to his kingdom in its size, and no limit to its kingdom in its endurance. Then we read in Colossians chapter 1, listen carefully, that it is the will, it is the purpose of the triune God that in all things he, the Lord Jesus Christ, the God-man, our mediator, it is the will and purpose of God that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. Now that which was spoken by the prophet, announced by the angels, and declared by his apostles has come to pass. Read it with me in the first four verses of Hebrews 1. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners, that is in different times and different ways, spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. In these four verses of Holy Scripture, God the Holy Ghost informs us that our Lord Jesus Christ, our God and our Savior, is superior to, greater than, and exalted above all things. He is superior to, greater than, and exalted above all things. In fact, a key word in the book of Hebrews is the word better. One purpose of this book is to show us that Christ is better than all who came before him. Particularly, the apostle is telling the Jewish believers, Christ is indescribably better than everything that prefigured and typified him in the Old Testament, in the ceremonial worship of the children of Israel, and in the events of Old Testament history. He's better than the prophets, better than the angels, better than Moses, better than Joshua, and a priest better than Aaron. He is a priest after the order of Melchizedek. He is a surety of a better covenant, established upon better promises, giving a better hope to needy sinners. Christ our Savior is better than the tabernacle, the altar, the temple, and the mercy seat. He's a better sacrifice, offering better blood, giving us better access to, and a better standing before the holy Lord God. For by him we are made the righteousness of God, the holiness of God. We are made to be the very wisdom of God and the redemption of God, accepted in the beloved. In all things, Christ is better than all others, infinitely better. He's the best. The title of my message this morning is The Unrivaled Excellence of Our Lord Jesus Christ. The unrivaled excellence of our Lord Jesus Christ. I choose the words unrivaled and excellence because I can't think of any better way, any more extravagant way to speak of our Savior's glory and dignity as the God-man, our Savior. And I can't imagine anything that would express his excellence, his glory, his majesty, and his dignity. So I try to use superlative words, the unrivaled excellence of our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen carefully. If you're ever tempted to imagine that there might be some similarity between the weak, frustrated, helpless Jesus of this idolatrous generation and the exalted Lord of glory, read these four verses again. Here we have the Christ of God revealed to us, the real Christ, our all-glorious Savior. And if the Christ you worship is not this Christ, the Christ you worship is Antichrist, a false Christ, and you will perish when God casts the beast and the false prophet into outer darkness. In these four verses of Holy Scripture, God the Holy Ghost shows us that our Savior is unrivaled in his excellence in nine ways. I'm going to give you each of them with great brevity, but I want you to get them. First, the Lord Jesus Christ is unrivaled in his excellence as the Word of God, the revelation of the invisible God. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. In the Old Testament, God spoke to men and women in the types and shadows, ceremonies and pictures of the law. And he spoke to men and women by the visions that he gave to faithful prophets, revealing his will and his purpose, his word and his law. All of those types, all of those pictures, all the messages of those prophets pointed to the Lord Jesus Christ. So that when you read the types, prophecies, and pictures of the Old Testament, you can see their fulfillment in only one person. Only one person. And that one person who fulfills it all is the Christ of God. And if the Christ you worship does not fulfill every type, every picture, every prophecy of the Old Testament scriptures, you worship a false Christ. Now, in these last days, God has spoken one time with finality by his Son. He hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. But what about the writings of the apostles and those who wrote the four gospels and the epistles of the New Testament and the book of Revelation? What about those things? Those things are but the writings of men recording for us by divine inspiration, giving explanation of the things which our Savior taught while he walked on this earth, and as he walked among men, revealing himself as God, the God-man, our mediator, the Christ. The Holy Spirit in the New Testament epistles, in the four gospels and the book of Acts, takes the things of Christ, the things revealed and spoken and taught by the Lord Jesus Christ, and shows them to us, causing the inspired apostles to give us a precise revelation of the fact that Jesus of Nazareth did indeed fulfill everything written in the Old Testament scriptures. He is the Word of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He is that one who is God manifest. He is God manifest. So that when Christ came in his humanity, came as one of us, and lived and obeyed God in our stead, and died upon the cursed tree, and rose from the dead, and ascended on high as the King of kings and Lord of lords, he manifest God in all his character. Lindsay was talking to us earlier about God's holiness. I said to him how inadequate we are when we think about, much less try to teach or preach about God's holiness. What is that holiness? It is everything about God that makes him different from everything and everyone else. It is the whole character of the excellent God, and that is Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. It is that which separates God from all his creatures. He is God manifest in the flesh. John tells us, no man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. He has taken all that God is and opened him up and showed him to you. He's taken all that God is and opened him up and showed him to you. The word from which that word declared is translated is the word exegeted. He is the exegesis of God. The Lord Jesus takes all the fullness fullness of God into humanity. And here is the Word, the revelation of God. Jesus Christ is God, and He is the Word of God. And the only way you can know God or come to God, the only way we can be accepted of God, is through Jesus Christ the Lord. God will not speak to, nor will He be spoken to by any man except through Christ the mediator. God will not make Himself known to any man but by Christ the mediator. The Lord Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Someone rightly said, "Christ is the way. Without Him, there's no going. Christ is the truth. Without Him, there's no knowing. Christ is the life. Without Him, there's no living." There is no prophet like Christ, our prophet. He is unrivaled in His excellence as the revelation of the invisible God. Second, look at verse 2. The Lord Jesus Christ is unrivaled in His excellence as the heir of God, the appointed heir of all things, whom He hath appointed heir of all things. We're told in John 3:35, "The Father loveth the Son, and hath given all things into His hand." Now, how can that be? If Jesus Christ is God the Son, in all things equal with God, fully Himself God, He possesses all things as God. That's exactly right. But because of His obedience unto God, the triune Jehovah, as our surety, as our mediator, as our Savior, as our substitute, the Father has given the Son all things, putting all things in His hands. He who is our Savior, by rightful, lawful possession, holds everything. He's the heir of all things. What does that mean? That means that He has the right, the absolute right, to do what He will with all things, you and me included. None can stay His hand or say unto Him, "What doest thou?" Who dares think about calling God into judgment? Who dares think it's not right for God? If God does it, it's right because God did it. I recall years ago listening, I forgot whether it was a hurricane or tornado or flood or earthquake, I forgot what it was, but listening to the news reporters, of course, they always get some religious fool to talk to him because he's got a degree of some kind or another. And he said, "I don't know what to say except when one of these days God's going to have to answer for a lot." God's going to have to answer to who? To who? None can stay His hand or say unto Him, "What doest thou?" If God wipes the world clean of humanity in the flood of His wrath, it's right. It's right. All that God is right. And all that God does is right. The Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, is the unrivaled sovereign of the universe. He sent His disciples out, sends you and I out with this word: "All power is given to me in heaven and in earth." All power. I have been asked a long time ago, folks don't argue with me much anymore because I don't argue very good. I just state things plainly. But if I believed in God's sovereignty like you do, why do you go preach? If you didn't, why would you? The motive, the inspiration for all evangelistic effort is all power belongs to Christ the Son, who is God our Savior. "Thou hast given Him power over all flesh for this purpose, that He should give eternal life to as many as Thou hast given Him." He who is God our Savior does as He will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. This is what that means. He makes one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor. One a vessel of mercy and another a vessel of wrath. One to show forth the riches of his grace and another to show the severity of his justice. And he does so exactly as it pleases him. Christ is the appointed heir of all things. Personally, the Father said to the Son, ask of me and I'll give you the heathen for your inheritance. And he is the appointed heir of all things for us representatively. He is the forerunner who has entered into heaven for us, taking possession of the inheritance in the name of his redeemed. And he is the heir of all things, being himself also the dispenser of all things. Everything that comes to pass, he brings to pass. Everything that comes to pass, he brings to pass. He's beautifully pictured by Joseph when Joseph was exalted by Pharaoh to be prime minister in Egypt. Pharaoh gave Joseph control over all the land, all the corn and wheat in the land, all the cattle in the land. Joseph held everything. And if you wanted anything from Pharaoh, folks would say, go see Joseph. He's the man in charge. Will you hear me? Jesus Christ, the God-man, is the God-man in charge of everything. Behold your God in the unrivaled excellence of Jesus Christ our Lord, the appointed heir of all things. Here's the third thing. By whom also he made the worlds. The Lord Jesus is unrivaled in his excellence as God, our Creator, the Creator of the worlds. I like the way that's stated. Now, some folks would read that and say, well, he said worlds, there must be a bunch of them, at least more than one. No, not at all. There's a reference, obviously, here to the distinct divinity and personality of our Lord Jesus Christ as God the Son. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And yet, it is equally obvious that our text speaks of Christ as our divine mediator, the one by whom the triune God performs all his will. Everything that God does, everything God has done in time, and everything that God will do in whatever tomorrows yet remain, he does through the mediation of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that the measurements of the universe were laid down by our Savior. The power of the sun and the brilliance of every star is energized by his sovereign, almighty, irresistible will. We were in Alaska, as you know, this past week. This time of the year there, they have about 6 hours of what they call daylight. Several years ago, Shelby and I made a list of things because we were forever leaving something we needed and have to go get it. So she has a checklist and she checks things off. And she always asks me, have you got your glasses? Have you got your sunglasses? My eyes always stay dilated. Sun bothers me a good bit. So I pack my sunglasses. Usually keep a pair in my briefcase. And we got to Alaska, didn't need them at all, even with the bright sunshine, because the sun doesn't shine up there this time of year. It's just a kind of cloudy haze for about 6 hours, what they call daylight. But we live here, where the sun shines with its brilliance and it glistens off of the snow. Christ Jesus is he who energizes the sun. Gives brilliance to the stars at night. It is Christ, our Savior, the great mediator and surety of his people, who laid the foundations of the earth. He's the creator of all things. He's not the great spectator, but the great creator. He's not the great evolver, but the great creator. When the Holy Ghost tells us that Christ is the creator of the worlds, he's not suggesting that there might be more than one inhabited planet, but rather he's telling us that Christ, holds the existence of every realm of existence in his hand as the creator. The heavenly world he created, the habitation of God and the holy angels. The upper world, the vast expanse of space. The lower world, the habitation of man. The world beneath, the prison of the damned. All created by him. Now you might be asking, Pastor, why is this so important? Why do you so vehemently insist on declaring that Christ made all things and rules all things in absolute sovereignty? Well, I'm glad you ask. To deny that Christ created all things and that he rules all things is to deny that he is God. God Almighty is the Creator, and the Creator is the mighty God, Christ Jesus, our God-man Savior. To deny that he is God is to mock him, blaspheme him, and deny his glory. To deny that Christ is God, sovereign upon his throne, is to deny hope to needy sinners who look to him alone for grace, salvation, and eternal life. We trust him. We trust him who is the mighty God. Creator, ruler of all things. That means our trust is well grounded. We trust one who is mighty to save. To this end, Christ both died and rose and revived that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. You see, none but an absolute sovereign can save. None but an absolute sovereign can be trusted implicitly. No one else. These two ladies here, and I presume you, trust me. I thank God that you do. I have, in measure, earned their trust. They know they can rely on me, but not absolutely. Not absolutely. Oh, no. Because I don't have any power. I don't have any ability. I don't possess anything. My next breath isn't mine yet. I may make promises I can't fulfill because God prevents it. I may have good intentions I cannot accomplish because of a lack of ability. I may even go back on my word in dishonesty because of my poor character. That could happen, but not God. He can be trusted implicitly with everything, with everything. I pray for that girl and her brother every day, throughout the day. And I tell you what I always do. I thank you, my God, I can commit them to you. That's good enough, isn't it? You tell me what's better. He who is God our Savior ought to be trusted implicitly. He's God. Only one who is an absolute sovereign can save and be trusted implicitly. And I'll tell you something else. Only one who is an absolute sovereign will be worshipped by his creatures. Men these days, women these days, go to church and do everything on this earth except worship God. They play games and they entertain themselves and one another and they have a big time and throw a party, but they don't worship God. Only an absolute sovereign demands worship. And only an absolute sovereign will be worshipped. You don't make bargains with him. You don't try to work out a deal with him. You bow and you worship like the leper of old. Lord, if you will, you can make me whole. Fourth, look at verse 3. Who being the brightness of his glory. Now, there's more there than I can get said in a long time. But that certainly declares to us that the Lord Jesus Christ is unrivaled in his excellence as the brightness of the glory of the triune God. Christ is the glory of his glory, who is glory. Christ is the glory of his glory, who is glory. He is God in all the fullness of Godhead. In him resides permanently. In him dwelleth all that God is in a body. In him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Who can talk about that? Mark Hansen, the Lord Jesus is seated in glory in a body I reckon about the size you are. I reckon about the size he is. Just average size man. Just average size man. Just a body. A real human body. But in the body of that man resides all the fullness of the infinite, incomprehensible Jehovah. Oh, what a God. What a Savior. The brightness of the Father's glory. He who is the glory of God, the brightness of the glory of God, certainly must have some allusion to the sun and its rays. They are of the same nature as Christ and the Father are one. As the sun and its rays are distinct and yet coexistent, so God the Father and God the Son are distinct and yet coexistent. As the sun and its rays can never be separated, the Father and the Son are forever united. As the rays of the sun radiate the glory of the sun, so Christ the Son of righteousness, radiates the glory of the invisible God. Jesus Christ, the God-man, is God in all the brightness of his glory as God. Now, as Brother L.R. Shelton used to say, hang on to your seat, we're fixing to jump a creek. As Christ is one with and inseparable from the Father, so we are one with and inseparable from him. That's exactly what he tells us in John 17. As he is one with and inseparable from the Father, we are one with and inseparable from him who is the God-man, our mediator. Number 5, look at verse 3 again. The express image of his person. The Lord Jesus is unrivaled in his excellence as the express image of the triune God. Not only does Christ reveal the brightness of God's glory, he is one with the Father. The same in substance with the Father. So that there's no inferiority in Christ. And there's no sequence whereby Christ follows behind the Father. John Gill suggests that this description of Christ implies three things. Equality with the Father and the Son. A sameness of essence in the Godhead. And the distinct persons in the Godhead. Those things we all recognize, but there's something else here that is commonly missed by men, I think. When the apostle here says that Christ is the express image of his person, I cannot help but to be convinced there is a direct reference to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. When God said, "Let us make man in our image and after our likeness." And so God made Adam in his own image. What does that mean? The Lord God, having accepted Christ his Son as our surety, our God-man mediator before the world was, before ever he assumed our nature, he stood before the Father as the God-man mediator, accepted of him. And the triune Jehovah said, let's make Adam look just like him. So he made him in the physical image of Christ, our God. And he made him in the moral image of Christ, our God, intellect, emotion, and will. So that Adam walked uprightly from the beginning, created in the full beauty and glory of perfect manhood. Our children, as we have been taught, it started a long time before this generation. We've been taught since we were knee-high to grasshoppers about cavemen. When I was just a little boy before starting in school, I can remember playing caveman. That meant you get a club, beat somebody, drag them around. Well, we didn't usually beat them too hard, but we try to get somebody to drag them by the hair. I'm the caveman. Adam was not a caveman. Adam was created with intelligence like no man has ever had since the fall. Adam was created with uprightness like no man by nature has had since the fall. Adam was created in the image of him who is the image of God. And far more importantly, according to Romans chapter 5, Adam was made in the covenant image of him who is the image of God. Romans 5 tells us that Adam was the figure of him that was to come. Not a figure, but the figure. He was the type. So that when God said, let's make man in our image and after our likeness, he said, let's make a man to represent the man who is God and the image of God. And he made Adam to be the covenant head of all humanity. So that Adam stood as the representative of Eve and of all the rest of humanity in the garden. And when Eve transgressed God's law and broke the law, nothing happened. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. She just the same as she was before. Because God didn't make the covenant with Eve, he made it with Adam. And when Adam saw what Eve had done, rather than being separated from the woman he loved forever, he took the forbidden fruit and willingly plunged himself into sin and death and damnation because of his love for Eve. And the whole human race was fallen and dead and corrupt and sinful by Adam's transgression. And there is another Adam, the last man, Jesus Christ the Lord. Now, understand this, and you're going to understand the Word of God. If you don't understand this, you will never understand the Word of God. Understand this, and you will understand grace and salvation. If you don't understand this, you will never understand grace and salvation. God deals with all men through two men. Just two men. The first Adam and the last Adam. The last Adam represents all God's elect. And he, because of his love for his people, took on himself our sin and was made what we are and plunged himself under the wrath of God and the judgment of God into death, that he might redeem us from the fall. And by one man's disobedience, we were made sinners. And by the obedience of this one man, Jesus Christ the Lord, we are made righteous. Here's the sixth thing. Upholding all things by the word of his power. Christ is unrivaled in his excellence, in the fact that he is the upholder of all things. By him all things consist. It is he who holds the universe in his hands. It is He who holds the universe in His hands. People talk about laws of nature and laws of science. Laws of nature are the laws of God. Laws of science are the laws of God. He upholds all things. It is He, Christ, our God and Savior, who upholds all things and determines all the affairs of providence. He preserves and He destroys. He kills and He makes alive. He enables and He disenables. Not by force of arms, but by the mere word of His power. Surely the wrath of man shall praise Thee, the psalmist says, and the remainder of wrath wilt Thou restrain. Our God is in the heavens. He hath done whatsoever He hath pleased. In heaven, in earth, in the sea, and in all deep places. Brother Don, where's that found? Psalm 135, verse 6. Well, that sounds like God always has His way in heaven, in earth, and hell. Among angels, men, and devils. Always. No exception. The preparations of the heart in man and the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directeth his steps. The lot is cast into the lap, but the whole disposing thereof is of the Lord. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. As the rivers of water, He turneth it whithersoever He will. That means that no event takes God by surprise. Nothing ever happens without His explicit direction. From the election of His people to salvation and everlasting glory, to the election of magistrates, to the consummation of the universe. Everything in the universe happens or not exactly at the will, decree, and order of Christ our God. One time, there was a rogue who thought David was done for, and he came out just jumping up and down like a fool and screaming and hollering and cussing David. And David's servant said, let me go over and take his head off his shoulders. And David, being the man he was, believing God as he did, he said, leave him alone. Leave him alone. Shimei could not cuss me, except the Lord said, Shimei, go cuss David. And perhaps the Lord will requite me good for his cursing this day. Everything is ruled by our God. Everything comes to pass by the direction of our God. I just caught Mark and Donna. They've been through so much. Teresa and David. Darvin and Kathy are going through so much. How come? Because God set His heart on you from eternity. That's how come. And the good and the evil is all good for those who love God, who are the called according to His purpose. When the Jews cried, crucify Him, crucify Him, and Pilate delivered Jesus to their will, when the soldiers nailed Him to the cursed tree and the mob spit in His face, He who was crucified was in absolute control of His crucifiers. When Judas came to betray Him with a kiss, Judas was but fulfilling the decree of God, the will of God, and the purpose of God for the saving of His people. I can almost hear our Savior as He hangs upon the cursed tree, covered in His own blood and the excrement of their vile throats. I can hear Him declare, therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life for the sheep. No man taketh it from me. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. Jesus Christ, the God-man who redeemed me, is the great King of the universe, upholding all things by the word of His power. Now, we come to the best of the text. He has by himself purged our sins. Our Lord Jesus is unrivaled in his excellence as the Redeemer of his people. Oh, glorious word, he hath by himself purged our sins. Now, once in the end of the world, hath he put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. He purged our sins. He purged our sins. All our sins, past, present, and future. He's taken them away by his blood, washed them away one time and one day forever, purged our sins so that they are no more. I don't know of a better way to illustrate it than to brag on my wife like I like to do. If you go out to dinner with me, I embarrass my wife and daughter and granddaughter all the time, especially if we get chips and salsa at a Mexican restaurant, because I'm going to get it on me. I'm going to get it on me. Hey, look here. Nothing there. Sometimes I'll make the mistake of leaving one of these rollerball pins out and stick it in my pocket. And after about 5 minutes, you got a big black circle right here. And I don't have one on any of my shirts. You know how come? This dear lady will go downstairs in the laundry room, and she'll soak those things, and she'll soak them in Clorox, and then she'll take Clorox and that granny stain remover stuff and scrub them, and scrub them, and dip them, and scrub them, and scrub them, and dip them, and scrub them, and scrub them, till her hands are raw. And it's gone. It's gone. Look here. Look here. Look here as God looks here. Did you hear what Jesus said to me? They're all taken away. Your sins are pardoned and you're free. They're all taken away. Christ has forever put away our sins, so that the Lord God hath not beheld iniquity in Israel or transgression in Jacob. Now look at the next thing. When he had by himself purged our sins, he sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Our Savior is unrivaled in his glorious exaltation. He who died for us sat down in heaven. That means his work is finished. He has entered into his rest. He who is the Lord, our Sabbath, is himself entered into his Sabbath, and his Sabbath, his rest, is his glory. Now he bids us enter into his rest. Rest in him. That's what it is to keep the Sabbath. We don't observe a physical Sabbath day. Now, I was raised in the South in the days when we had what they call blue laws. That meant that you couldn't buy anything on Sunday except a hamburger. That's it. You go out to a restaurant and eat your meal. That's it. You couldn't buy anything else. In an emergency, you could call a pharmacist and buy drugs because folks were keeping a Sabbath. Well, I'm not in favor of Sabbath keeping. I would like to see blue laws. I wish you couldn't do anything on Sunday except come here. That kind of forced folks to be here. But I'd love that, but not Sabbath keeping. No, no. If you try to keep a physical Sabbath, you will never rest in the Sabbath. You will never find rest in him who is our Sabbath. This is what it is to believe on the Son of God. It is to enter into his rest. Quit working. Quit working. Quit trying to win God's favor. Quit trying to make it into God's approval, but rather rest in Christ Jesus the Lord. One more thing. Our Lord Jesus is unrivaled in his excellence by reason of his excellent name which he's obtained. Being made so much better than the angels, as he hath obtained a more excellent name than they. What is his name? What is his name? Some folks still do. There was a day when people named children for a reason. Their name meant something. I had no idea why my folks named me Donald Stewart. I got Fortner because that was my daddy's name. But Don either means a mighty ruler or a little brown stranger. I'm not either one. And I'm sure not much of a steward. But the Lord Jesus bears his name. Jesus Christ the Lord. The Lord Jesus Christ. Because it represents all that he is, all that he does, all that he gives, his person, his performance, his perfection, and his promises. His name is the name, the only name, by which sinners are saved. He gives life eternal to as many as believe on his name. His name is the only name that has power with God. Mark Daniel, you have power with God. Do you know that? Power, he chose you. That whatsoever you ask in my name, my Father will give it you. Power with God. The name that prevails with God. Oh, that means we can get God in an arm lock and make him do what we want him to. No, 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 no. That means God gives us a heart to seek his will and his glory, and we get from God everything we want. His will, his glory. Was there something else you wanted? Was there something else you wanted? No, just his will. Just his glory, that's all. His name is the name that must be acknowledged and confessed. And one day, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus the Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And he sent us into this world to preach his name among all nations. Preach his name among all nations. I appreciate people being kind, expressing gratitude for labor, for preaching the gospel. I appreciate it more than I can tell you. I appreciate your encouragement. But oh my soul, unto me, who am the less than the least of all human beings, God's given this grace that I should preach to this generation the unsearchable riches of God, the unsearchable riches of God's grace in Jesus Christ the Lord. Trust in his name and go home rejoicing in the Christ of God. Amen.
Number 106.